Glory to God. We are very thankful to God for the lessons we have been learning as we're doing a book study in the Epistle of James. And the primary focus of the Epistle of James is about attitudes. Can you say attitudes? Attitude affects everything in our lives. Okay? It affects how will we respond to experiences, to challenges, temptations, and trials. Attitude determines how we respond to insults and injustice, no? And attitude is most important to God because unless attitude will change, nothing else will. Okay? Can we say that together? Unless attitude changes, nothing else will. Amen? Remember, we find true happiness and peace not because our circumstances have changed, not because people around us have changed. We find true happiness and peace because we have changed. Amen? When your attitude begins to change, you will learn to love people unconditionally, to forgive, to show kindness to those who insult you, to learn to trust God to vindicate you in His own way, in His own time. When you believe that God will keep His promise, it's just a matter of time. You're able to face any challenge because you know that you are secure in the hands of your Heavenly Father. Amen? And that's why you don't have to take offense, because what people say or do to you does not define you. It defines them. Okay? What defines you is God's love and grace in Christ. Amen? So can you say to the person beside you, I am defined not by what people think about me, not about what people say about me. I am defined by my attitudes. Okay? So that's why a lot of us sometimes go to needless suffering and pain, because not because of what people do to us, but because of the negative attitude that we have towards them for what they have done to us. Remember, peace is a choice. Joy is a choice. That's why when the Word of God says in Philippians 4, rejoice always. How can you rejoice always when every day you're facing hurting things, disappointments, and sometimes even, you know, opposition from people, you know, and frustration with your spouse or with your parents or with your children, okay? How could you rejoice? Because joy is not about your circumstances. Joy is about your commitment to trust God that this too will pass because God is in control. And when you choose to believe in what God has promised to you, you have reasons to rejoice even if you're still going through adverse or painful circumstances. Do you agree? Okay, can you say to the person beside you, your attitude matters more than what people do to you. Okay? So James is focused on attitudes. He, in his epistle, he focuses on wrong attitudes and is focusing on right attitudes, because this is what affects our life every day. Okay? So remember James? James, who was James again? Review. This James is the half-brother of Jesus, our Savior, the son of Mary and Joseph. James was the eldest, second to Jesus, according to Mark chapter 6. The name of James is mentioned always first in the list, which means that James must be the firstborn after Jesus was born. Of course, the firstborn of Joseph and Mary, because Jesus was conceived in Mary's womb before they got married. Okay? So Jesus is the Son of God. Okay? But not necessarily the son of Joseph. Okay? So this James is also the brother of the other writer of an epistle, the epistle of Jude. Again, his name is mentioned in Mark 6. Jude is one of the brothers of James, the half-brother of Jesus Christ. Okay? It's wonderful to see here that while these brothers, according to the Gospels, were critics of Jesus, they did not believe their brother, all the things he was saying. They were actually, you know, talking bad about Jesus, you know, when Jesus was still doing his ministry. But praise God, you know, even your worst critics can one day become your friends. So don't make judgments on people just because they're against you today, they're mean to you, they're doing things to hurt you. forgive them, okay? Because every human being is a work in progress. Don't make a judgment that just because it's like that to you today, he will always be like that, okay? Amen? Who knows, that very person is trying to make life hard for you, one day will be the one to save you from your economic troubles. Amen? Because people are still unfinished products. Amen? We always emphasize that here in BCI. That's where in BCI, no condemnation, no judgment. You can come here, you may feel guilty because you fall into adultery, you may be a gay person and you feel bad about what you're doing. Maybe you come from other places where you're condemned and judged and ostracized. Here, you're very much welcome. Because here, we uphold a spirit of grace. We are a church without walls. And not only that, we focus on building bridges instead of building walls. Amen? So can you say to the person beside you, God has forgiven you, why shouldn't I? Because I'm also forgiven. Amen? Okay? So Christians are not perfect. They're just forgiven. Can we say that together? Christians are not perfect. They're just forgiven. Amen? So, well, James begins talking about trials in chapter 1, remember? And then he highlights, he's always putting into focus one particular wrong attitude that manifests in our words. Can we say words? Okay? Do you know that words can make or break relationships? Right? Remember the story I told you, some people come to me for counseling, Pastor, pray for me. Why? Impierno yung aming pamilya. Impierno daw yung pamilya niya. Pag-pray mo nga kami, Pastor, inatake kami ng demonyo. Okay, sis, sandali lang ha. Number one, sabi sa James chapter 3, kinote ko ito, maganda makita po natin, James chapter 3 verse 6, yung impierno, dumadaan sa ating mga salita. Walang salita, walang impyerno. Ayan. The tongue sets the whole course of your life on fire and is itself set on fire by hell. Sabi ko, kaya nagiging impyerno yung pamilya nyo dahil sa mga salitang binibitawan nyo si isa't isa. Kung very offensive kayo magsalita, talagang hinahatak yung impyerno sa inyong pamilya. Because puno ng galit. Okay? And we know from Ephesians 4, verse 26 to 27, pag pinapatagal ang galit sa puso, you attract demonic powers into your family, into your life. Ayan po, Ephesians 4, 26 to 27. So I explained to her, you know, your home will never be hell if you know how to control your tongue. And how you deal with your anger. Okay? Kaya nagiging impyerno kasi puro galit. Do you agree? Do you agree? The reason why it looks like hell because anger is always there. There's no forgiveness. There's no allowance for growth for the other person. A person must be perfect every day or else. And so, I told her, and the devil cannot attack you or touch you if you have the right attitudes. Because demonic powers only exploit your attitudes. They use that. It becomes an open door for them. Wrong attitudes is an attraction to the other side. Okay? James mentioned that also in James chapter 3. James 3, 14 to 16. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny truth. Next. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly and spiritual and of the devil, demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, those are the two sins that divide any community of people, family, church, organization. When there is selfish ambition on one side, jealousy on the other side, you can be sure that community will not last long. Okay? So when there is an envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. So what were these Jewish Christians that James is addressing guilty about? They were guilty about what kind of attitude? Selfish ambition and jealousy. Okay? So that's why in any church where there is selfish ambition and jealousy, all kinds of disorder is going to take place. Okay? That's why we teach that we need to learn how to forgive people and we need to humble ourselves and rather value others more than we value ourselves. Okay? So what we see here is that at the roots of all the discord in the life of the church, of the communities that James was writing to, was this attitude of selfish ambition and jealousy. Okay? That happens among siblings, right? Right? Especially when the inheritance is about to be divided. Right? Okay. So, what are we learning here? That our words are determined by our attitudes. What we say reveals who we are. Can you say to your person beside you, your words define you. And they define what's going to come to you. Remember what Proverbs says, death and life is in the power of the tongue. And blessed are they who eat of its fruit. If you use your tongue in the right way, in blessing people and declaring the promises of God, you will receive the positive results of what you say. So your words not only define who you are, they define what's going to come to you. Okay? So that is why we need to learn to bless even those who offend us, because we want God to bless us more. Amen? Okay? So, James focuses on the sins of the tongue. So in James chapter 1, he gives this introductory idea about the subject in chapter 1, verse 26. Okay? This is his first time to mention about the tongue. If anyone considers himself religious and yet does not keep a tight rein on his tongue, he deceives himself and his religion is worthless. Okay. You know, James sounds very offensive, right? He's just too frank, right? Remember, as I told you, there are two kinds of messages that is preached on the pulpits every Sunday. There are what you call massage messages. You know what massage messages is? These are more focusing on encouragement, inspiring people. There's nothing wrong with that, okay? But if all you're having is massage, you don't know that the problem of why you're having pain in your back because you have a disease inside your body. Hindi mo alam, may cancer ka na pala. E nakala mo massage yung sasagot dun sa sakit sa likod mo, okay? So that's why sometimes massage helps, but there are times surgery solves the problem. And messages like James are surgical. They cut deep in order to bring healing and restoration to you. Right? Okay? And so, he mentions that. And then in chapter 3, of course, the entire chapter is focused on the things of the tongue. James 3, verse 9, this is what he says. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who are made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers, this should not be. Amen? So we're here every Sunday praising God, but if during the week we speak degrading words to our neighbor, James is saying, that should not be. Okay? That's what you call hypocrisy. If you praise God, learn to love your neighbor. Because the measure of your worship is defined by your relationship with your neighbor. Can I say that together? Our worship is measured and defined by how we relate with our neighbor. Okay? Matthew chapter 5, verse 23 to 24 shows that to us. Okay? Matthew 5, verse 23. Therefore, if you are an offering your gift at the altar and remember that your brother has something against you because you offended that brother, and you remember, God is reminding you, you offended your brother. Okay? And leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. What is Jesus saying? If you come to worship me and somebody is offended against you and you remember that, I want you to leave my temple, go to that person, first be reconciled, and then come back and only then will I accept your offering. In other words, what is God saying? Our worship is unacceptable if you have not reconciled with a brother or sister we have offended. Our love for God is revealed in our love for our brother. Do you understand this? That is why hypocrisy can take place in our life when we claim, we love you, Lord, we praise you. But when you turn the back, oh, we say all manner of evil against people. You understand what the Word of God is saying about? Okay? And then somebody gets offended because of what you said. Jesus said, I will not accept your worship until you ask forgiveness from your brother. Okay? Your worship is measured and defined by how you relate with your neighbor. Amen? Now, we get now to chapter 4, verse 11. This is our main text, 11 and 12, just two verses. So this is where we are now in our exposition of the Epistle of James. Brothers, do not slander. You know what slander is? Saying degrading words against somebody. Saying words that degrade the identity of another human being. That's slander. Okay? Do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against his brother or judges him. So we often are guilty of slander because we are judging people. You got that? Okay? Because if you have not made any conclusion in your heart about this person, you have nothing to say. Right? But if you have a negative judgment, it will come out in your mouth and you will say something really negative about the person. You understand this? Okay? So James is telling us, when you speak against your brother, it is because there's already judgment taking place in your heart. And you judge him, speaks against the law, and judges it. When you judge the law, you are not keeping it, but sitting in judgment on it. There is only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your brother? Who is the only one who can really judge the hearts of men? God, because only God knows the secrets, the inner motives and intents of people. That's only God can give righteous judgment. And only God can say when your motive is against his law or your motive is abides with his law. Only God decides that because he is the judge, okay? So when the law says do not do this, you may see the person doing something, but you may not know what's really the motive behind. Do not speak against your brother because you don't know what's the real motive of the person. You're making judgment that he is breaking the law. Okay? And now become your own judge. Let God do the judging. Amen? Your job is to encourage the brother. Amen? Can we say this together? My job is to encourage people when they are doing wrong. It is not my job to make judgments. Okay? Because you are not omniscient. You don't know everything about the heart of the person. So who are you to make judgment? Only God is the judge. Amen? So if you see something wrong, if you're in doubt and you're suspicious, what do? Do not judge. Ask. Can you say this together with me? When in doubt, don't ask. Do not judge. One more time. When in doubt, ask. Do not judge. So when somebody behaves in a way that, you know, you take offense about it, you go to the person, check it out first. Sis, what did you mean when you said this? Or sister, what did you mean when you did this? Ask first. Okay? Don't judge that the person is intentionally trying to offend you or intentionally trying to ignore you. Right? You went into church, you said hi to a sister, did not respond to you, and you make a judgment, sungit. Right? And then later on, you see him worshiping the other, and he's crying. And later on, after the service, he comes to you, hey, sis ka dyan? Binati kanina before the service, you did not even look at me. Ay, sis, I did not know. Sorry, sis, kasi when I came to church, my heart was really bleeding. I was going through a lot of things right now. That's why I don't notice people around me. No intention, sis. Okay. Because you made a judgment. You understand that? So when you're in doubt, don't judge. Ask. If you really want to know, why did he do this? Why did he say that? Okay, sis, just want to know, why did you say that? Amen. Okay, can we make that a habit? When in doubt, ask, do not judge. Because only one can see the hearts, not you. Do not judge, okay? So, do not slander one another, okay? And we find that this is a very important warning, because in the same chapter, in verse 1 up to verse 2, this was the problem going on with these Jewish Christians. Can we see that, verse 1 to 2 of chapter 4? They were going through a lot of quarrels and fights. There you are. A lot of quarreling. Right? When there's a lot of quarreling, usually there's a lot of judging. Okay? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? Remember what is the problem of these people? Selfish ambition and jealousy. Why? Because they're so materialistic. They want power. They want more. More for them, less for others. Selfish ambition. Okay? And not only that, you want something, but you don't get it. So what do? You kill. Is James really being literal about this? He's talking to believers, right? Is he talking to believers? Yes. They're Jewish Christians, according to James chapter 1, verse 1 to 2. You kill and covet, but you cannot have what you want. You quarrel and fight, you do not have, because you do not ask God. So are they Christians? So when he said, if you do not get what you want, you kill. What does he mean? Is he really stabbing the person like that? No. James knows the language of Jesus. Remember, he heard his half-brother teach about these things. Okay? We find that in Matthew chapter 5, verse 21 to 22. Okay? Matthew chapter 5 tells us what constitutes murder. Okay? You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. So what happens when you're a murderer? You're brought into court for judgment, right? But I tell you that anyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. So what is Jesus saying? If you're angry with your brother, you will be brought to the court and be liable for judgment. So what is he saying? That once you have vindictive anger against your brother, how does that connect with the thou shalt not murder? What is the connection? He said, before it was said, do not murder. But I say to you, if you're angry with your brother, you're going to go to court. That means you are a murderer. Okay? Again, anyone who says to his brother, Raka, you know what Raka means? Wala kay pulus. You good for nothing is an Aramaic word. Jesus spoke Aramaic when he was on earth. This was a transliteration from the original words of Jesus. He said, Raka, that means you good for nothing. Wala ka pulos. It's answerable to the Sanhedrin is the Supreme Court, the religious Supreme Court of Israel. It is the highest court. Only the most heinous crimes are brought to the Sanhedrin, including blasphemy against God and murder. Okay? So Jesus is saying, if you say you're good for nothing, in the eyes of God, you're guilty of a murder whose level brings you to the Supreme Court. Its gravity brings you to the Supreme Court. And anyone who says, ala, ano ba yan sa Bisaya? Okay, say, tahimik lang, mahina lang. Will be in danger of the fire of hell. Kaya sabi ko, yung bahay na mukhang impyerno, maraming salitang ganyan. It's all slanderous words. This is all slander. Degrading words against your neighbor. And when it is fueled by anger, Jesus is saying that is no different than the act of a murderer. In God's eyes. In God's eyes. Amen? 1 John chapter 3, verse 15. John, of course, who was with Jesus, who heard Jesus' teaching, interprets it this way in his epistle of John. Anyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life in him. And James echoes that in his epistle, say, you don't get what you want, and you kill him. like that. Okay? You know, one of the saddest things I have as a counselor is when a group of siblings come to me and tell me that because the father died and the inheritance now is being divided, some sibling can even be almost murderous just to get the bigger portion of the inheritance that is not assigned to him or her. I've had many counseling cases like that. I said, well, it's either you bring your brother to court or let it go. Anyway, that money is not your life. Let him have it. Because there will be judgments in the end. Okay? But if you want to have justice, go to court. Present evidence that it is divided equally among the siblings and somebody's wanting to get more than what has been allotted. Okay? And there's hatred against that brother. Okay? It happens. Almost wanting to kill the person. In fact, there was even one sibling who told me, Pastor, parang gusto ko talaga patayin siya eh. Grabe ka, greedy! Nakalimutan niya kami, mga kapatid niya, hirap na hirap kami financially, tapos siya mayamat, kukunin niya lahat ng mana. Oh, di ba? Sounds familiar to some of you, no? Okay. He who hates his brother is a murderer. Okay? That is why you try to covet things, you don't get that, and you start slandering the person. This is what the Word of God is concerned about. Slander. Okay? And so, Leviticus 19:16, we are also warned, do not go about spreading slander among your people. Anong tawag diyan? Pag kinakalat ng slander, what do you call that? Gossip. Okay? Proverbs 10:18, but the Word of God says, whoever slanders his neighbor in secret, him I will put to silence. Okay? You know, this is a very relevant message of James because this is so true of Filipino culture. So true of Filipino culture. That's why we need to be careful about how we handle our attitudes that come out in our mouth in words that degrade our neighbor. Okay? So, pero pastor, okay, that's gossip. Let's take a look at Romans 1, 29-30. Gossip and slander are often together in the list of sins in the New Testament. Gossip and slander. So you find this in Romans 1, verse 29-30. Talking about the people of the world who have rejected God. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossip slanderers. How, you see how those two come together? They are gossip slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. Whoops. They disobey their parents. Next. Okay? 31-32. They are senseless, faithless, heartless, ruthless, although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death. They not only continue to do these very things, but also approve. Ay, okay lang. Sige, siraan mo siya, Brad. Sige, approve. Sige, slander him. Okay? But also approve those who practice them. What's God's punishment for gossip and slander? Death. Under God's law. You understand this, okay? Because that is like cursing or degrading a human being created in God's likeness just like you. That's why only God has the right to do that. Because only God knows the hearts of people. We don't know what's going on in the life of that person you're trying to slander. You don't know what is going through. That's why nakakagawa siya ng mga maling desisyon. That's why he can be very offensive because you don't know what is going through in his life. You understand that? Slandering him just makes it worse. Okay? So, the Word of God is very clear about this. Here's another scripture that puts them together. And that's in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 20. Again, both of these come together. Okay? 2 Corinthians 12, 20. I fear that there may be quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, factious, slander, gossip, arrogance, and disorder. Okay? But there's a question, Pastor. How do you differentiate report versus gossip? Somebody comes to me, Pastor Dave, do you know that this brother is doing this? Oh, really? How sure are you? Well, I saw it with my eyes. Really? Now, why are you telling this to me? Because, Pastor, you're the only person who can do something about it. Okay. Okay. What is your desire? Well, Pastor, let's help the brother get back. Okay. That's a report. Okay? What's the difference between a report and a gossip? Okay, we find examples, for example, of reports to Paul. 1 Corinthians 1:11. Here's an example of a report. Okay. My brother Sam from Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. Gossip. Is this gossip? Or report? Is this gossip? Or report? Okay. So, Pastor, what's the difference between a report and a gossip? Three things. Number one, who is the addressee? A report will always approach only a person who is in the position or responsibility to resolve the matter, not just to anybody. Gossip will address the story just to anybody, especially your friends. Who have no position, no responsibility to resolve the issue. Okay? You get what I'm saying? It is defined by your addressing. To whom are you saying this? If you spread it around, ay, si ano ganito? Ay, si ano ganyan? Ay, Brad, alam mo, si ano ganyan? Now, why is that gossip? Because the people being shared, what's being the story, are people who are not in a position or not within a responsibility to deal with the issue and resolve it. Okay? So, number one is address. And number two is the motive. Why are you sharing it? If the motive is out of concern for the person because you want to put things right, okay, it's coming out of love and concern in order to protect another person or to put him in the right track, then that's a report. If the motive is you're ventilating anger in your desire to discredit and malign this person, ay, pare, ganyan, anong ganyan, ganyan, that's gossip. When the motive is not love and concern, a desire to help the person resolve the issue, if the desire is just, you know, to have the delights of talking something bad about another human being, or out of your anger against the person, you want to malign him with this other person by talking all bad things about him, that's gossip. The motive defines whether it's a report or gossip. And thirdly, the nature of the what is being shared. Okay? If it is simply factual, inform me that there are quarrels among you. Is that factual? Does it involve judgment of motives? No. It's just, they're really quarreling. They're fighting. But he's not saying they have murderous intents. They're selfish. They're ambitious. No judgment is made. Just facts. Okay? Gossip involves judgment. Alam mo, palagay ko, kaya niya ginawa yan kasi nagsiselos talaga yan. Patay. Who are you to say na yun ang motive? Okay? The moment you make judgments on the motives of a person and tell it to another person, that's already gossip because it's not just focusing on the facts. It's focusing now on judgments. You understand that? So those are the three things that distinguish a report and a gossip. Number one, who is it addressed to? Is it the right person that can really resolve the problem? Okay? Or just anybody else? Number two, okay, what's the motive for sharing this? Is it because out of love and concern to protect people, to protect the person, to help the person get back on the right track? That's why you're approaching the right person who can deal with the issue. Para maayos. Okay? Or are you sharing this because just want to you know, and find delight in just talking about bad things about people. Or because you're angry at the person and you want to malign him and make people feel how bad he is. Okay? That's gossip. And third is what? The nature of the story. Is it purely factual or does it involve judgment? The reason why you report is so that the person who is in a position can investigate and find out what the motive is. You got that? But the one reporting cannot talk about motives because it has not yet been investigated. How do you know that's the motive? You have not even asked the person yet. You got the point? That's why a report is just factual, and let the person who receives it be the one to investigate and make the final judgment. Okay? So, report versus slander. So what do we do when we're offended by another person? Okay, what do we do when we're offended by another person? So let's take a look at Matthew 18, verse 15 to 7. What do we do when we're offended by a person? Our tendency sometimes is to talk to others about it, right? If the motive is to help the person, that's great. It's a report. So what do we do when we're offended by a brother? If your brother sins against you or sins in any way, go and show him his fault just between the two of you. Do it privately. Okay? So, when somebody you're offended by somebody and you took offense, remember, say this with me, offense is a choice. You can choose to take offense or you can choose not to take offense. You choose not to take offense when you just learn how to forgive as a way of life. People are not perfect. Okay, that's his weakness. I have my weakness. It's okay. I won't even think about it. Okay? If your attitude is that you tend to overlook the sins of others, then you will not be offended. You got the point? If you're willing to forgive the person immediately, then you don't have any offense anymore. Right? Or you choose to understand the person, where he is coming from. I know this guy, I don't think he means evil by what he did, but I know he means well, just going through a lot of things in his life. So you're not, are you offended? No, you're not offended. So do you understand what we mean when we say offense is always a choice? Okay? But if you do take offense, and maybe the reason is because you really want to help this person correct his way of life, then that's nice, that's good. Okay? So there you have a reason now to go to him. Not because you're taking offense, but because you really want to encourage this brother to do what is right. Okay? So you go to him and tell him about it, just between the two of you. So when you are offended, what do? Go! Right? What's the first command? Go! Okay? The problem is, we go and tell the world about it. No, go to him. Okay, go to him, tell him. So he went to the guy, and he's with a group of friends. You know what you did in front of the friends. Yeah, you told him, but you told him publicly. No, go to him and tell him privately. Just between the two of you. Amen? You know, it's so hard for Filipinos us to do this. Because we're non-confrontational. Nahihiya tayo. Totoo hindi. We feel ashamed if we confront the person, but we are so shameless when we gossip about it. Di ba parang contradiction yun? You feel, ay, huya man ako sabihin sa kanya, sino ba ako? Pero ang bayan, siya ganyan. Pero napaka-shameless, kakagossip. Kaya parang talaga mang marunong tumahiya o walang hiya ito. You got the point there? So, that is what James, the Word of God, is trying to say. So when you are offended, go to the person concerned and tell him about it. You know why? Because you don't know if it was intentional. You don't know if he was even aware that he hurt you. You will not know until you go to him. That's why we often make judgments, and our judgments hurt us more than the fact. Because the fact is, maybe that person never really thought anything bad about you, but you made a conclusion because of your judgment. Now you're hurting yourself, and the person had nothing to do about it. Can you say to the person beside you, much of our hurts are self-imposed. because of our attitudes. You understand this? Okay? That is why, go to the person. And if he listens to you, if the person is sincere, he will definitely hear you. I'm sorry, I did not mean that, okay? You have won your brother over. But there are cases when the brother will deny it. Right? Have you experienced that? You tried to tell the person, you know, you were offended by this. Oh, no. So what does the Word of God say? But if you have listened, take one or two others along, for every matter must be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. So you find somebody who also witnessed what he did. So the Word of God says, bring with you two or three witnesses. God did not say, bring with you two or three gossipers. What do you mean by that? You are bringing people who heard from another, from another, from another. Those are not witnesses. They're gossips. Witnesses are people who actually saw what the person did. Witnesses are people who can testify he heard exactly what he said. Right? Now, when you're trying to confront somebody, sometimes it's hard to find witnesses because you are the only person who saw it. Right? So, if he denies it, you have a problem. Okay? The issue is not resolved because he denies it and you have no other witness. So, what do you do? Forgive and let it go. Okay? Because you don't have enough evidence. Okay? Forgive and let it go. Bahala na si Lord sa kanya. Amen. Romans chapter 12, verse 19. Bahala na si Lord sa kanya. You know this, right? Let God do what He is a specialist in doing. Avenging. You get the point there? I heard this story about in Australia, about the natives in Australia who were really brutalized, exploited by the British, soldiers from the British, in centuries ago. I just don't remember the details. Definitely there were protests about the abuse and exploitation of the natives during their time, but there was no justice. No justice. But recently, it came out in the news that those, I don't know if the descendants of the soldiers or the soldiers who were involved, you know, or the descendants, I can't remember. Or the army group where they were a part of before, went to these natives and publicly apologized for the actions of their ancestors against them centuries ago. Was justice delivered? And then these natives choose to forgive them. Okay? But it happened centuries later. In God's time. Not all issues of justice can be settled in one generation. But if you trust God, you can be sure a time will come that justice will be served. You understand this? Social justice is a very challenging matter. You cannot always have social justice unless you have to kill the people involved. But who are we to make that choice? In the end, God alone executes final justice. If not in this life, in the next one. You understand that? God says, I will avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. But as for you, forgive, leave it to God. God will deal with it His way, His time. You understand that? You may lose your life trying to fight for justice. What a waste. When God can handle it better in His own way and in His own time. You understand that? Okay? It's mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. So if the person doesn't listen to you, let it go and let God. Move on with your life. Don't allow the offense of another person to hinder you from enjoying life because that's your choice, not his. You understand that? Okay? So that's why it's important for us to go to the person, find out if he'll admit it so that you will have restoration or reconciliation. But if he doesn't listen to you, going back to Matthew chapter 18, if not listening, bring it to the church. Do not papasok ang church to implement discipline against that brother or sister na ayaw umamin na kasalanan sa'yo. Okay? That's where the community comes in to help you get justice. Okay? So, how do we keep ourselves from slandering people? Philippians 4:8, Paul recommends this. You know, it's our human nature to be attracted to the negative, no? Especially in a shame-based culture like the Philippines and many countries in Asia, and surprisingly, certain aspects of Western culture tend to be shame-based also. Okay? Shame-based culture seeks to modify behavior by shaming the person or cursing the person. So the method of changing behavior is by degrading the person to challenge him to prove himself against all the curses and degradation. That's shame-based culture. Okay? And because of that, we are so used to always finding what's wrong. You're always used to finding what's wrong with a person. But the Word of God tells us if you want to build healthy relationships with people, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent, praiseworthy, think about such things. If your attitude is vindictive, if your attitude is judgmental, you will always take offense and try to hit back. And doesn't bring peace to you. It brings all kinds of disorder. You understand that? God calls us to a life of peace. That's why in Romans chapter 12, as far as it lies in you, Paul writes, live in peace with all men as far as it lies with you. Of course, when you need justice, go for it. But remember, justice will not always be served based on our human justice system. Only God can administer final justice. So you have a choice, okay? You can choose to wait for 25 years or more to settle a civil case, or you can stop, you know, wasting that money, put your trust in God, and let God give you justice His way, His time. Amen? So focus rather on what you can affirm in people around you. Okay? You know what God saw in you? Even though we were in the midst of our sinful rebellion, Romans 5:8 says, God demonstrates His love for us in this, that we were while we were yet sinners, rebels, offensive, enemies of God, Christ died for us. Only the model of Christ can change the world. Only the model of Christ can change the world. You cannot answer evil with evil. You just added evil. You cannot answer darkness with darkness. You just increased the darkness of the world. You overcome darkness by shining your light so bright that later on the darkness is overcome. That's why the Word of God says in Romans 12:21, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil by good. In the end, good alone has the power to overcome evil. Not evil against evil, because evil will only become evil and evil and evil. Are you talking? You understand what this is all about? That's why Christ said, you are the light of the world. Let your light so shine among men that they will see your good works and bring glory to your Father in heaven. Focus on what you can affirm in people. Because everybody have human we all have human defects, we all have weaknesses, people have their own issues in their life. Find what you can affirm in people. Just as God affirmed us, even though we were so offensive, He chose to see value in us, value enough, worth dying for. Amen? That's why we rejoice. Because while we were sinners before, God forgave us and accepted us and gave us everything that we never deserved. Understand that? In closing, let me share my experience when I was invited to speak sa what's the name of this youth group. Okay. This is a youth activist group in Compostela Valley. They gathered all the members of this youth group. I'm trying to remember. Kabataan, ayun. What do you call that youth group? Social youth group who tend to be activists? Kilisan ng mga... Something like that, okay? So, their heads from the different... There were 11 municipalities in Compostela Valley Province. And the people, the young men and women who attended that conference were the heads of those chapters ng youth movement na ito. And so, I was dealing with young people who are very activist. And I know what is in their hearts. Some of them already been killed by rightists in the government. They were already, some of them were massacred. Some of them were under threat to their life from rightists in the government at the time. And I was there in front of them, and I said, what a waste if the lives of these young people, you know, are laid down for something that they cannot change in their lifetime. And so I asked God for wisdom. How can I encourage these young people to focus on modeling, building, rather than criticizing? The easiest thing in the world to do is to criticize. The most challenging thing to do is how can you change that by providing a better model. It's easy to talk about change. It's easy to campaign for change because everybody wants change. It's easy to preach about change. The hardest thing to do is to change. If you cannot model it, why do you demand it? Understand this? So I tell these young people, I told them what Buckminster Fuller said. I love this statement, and you will love it when you understand it's in line with Jesus' teaching. Buckminster Fuller, you know Buckminster Fuller? Buckballs in physics was named after him. He was the one who designed the geodesic dome. You remember the geodesic dome? He was the one who created that. Okay, he's a thinker, architect, he's a man of so many talents. Listen to what Buckminster Fuller, I share this with these activist young people. You can never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that will make the existing one obsolete. Did you get that? You can never change things by fighting the existing reality. Why? Because the existing reality is ready to defend itself to the death. If you want to change something, he said, build a new model that will attract the attention of the world, that will make the existing one obsolete. I told them, why do you spend your energies trying to fight something you may never be able to demolish for your entire lifetime? Some of you have been killed, and some of you may yet to be killed. Why do you devote yourself to build a new model that will one day make this one obsolete? And I asked them this question, kayong mga kabataan, ano pa nagagawa ng ibagsak? Let's say bumagsak. Okay? Let's say bumagsak. Sino ang papalit sa kanila? Who will take their place? You? Can you prove to them you are better? You are wiser? You are more self-sacrificing? You truly have social responsibility? Can you prove to them you'll be a new generation of this who have integrity? Show it right now. And stop talking about it. How are you practicing integrity in your lives right now? Do you lie? Do you cheat in your exams? Then you talk about these people? If you want to change the Philippines, be the change that this nation is waiting for. If you cannot model the change, kahit ibagsak mo palihan na sila, ang papalit sa kanila, ganun pa rin. Unless you produce a new generation of young men with great leadership capacity who would prove to be men and women of integrity and social compassion. Tahimik po lahat ng kabataan. I challenge you to shine your light so bright that in time, your light will overcome the darkness of this nation. It is better to light a candle than to curse the darkness. If you want change, start with you. Now, and I challenge you, show them how it must be done. Show them the qualities that is absent in them. Show them you have those qualities. If you cannot prove that, we are bound to repeat our mistakes. Everybody, there's around 300 heads. Kabataang makabayan. Eh? Remember that. They were all silent. And I prayed, who of you here are committed to be a model of change? Who will you withstand for true integrity even in your private life? Because who you are in private will one day affect your public life. You can never hide what you are in secret forever. Who will stand for integrity here? No cheating, no lying, no taking advantage of others' weaknesses. Who will you withstand and say, I will stand for integrity? Gradually, hands went up, started to stand. Girls were starting it. And then the guys started standing. I said, are you committed to shine your light rather than criticize the darkness? Criticizing doesn't change anything. It is modeling that has the promise of genuine change. You know what happened? There were so many tears shed. I led them to Christ and trust God to empower you, to give you the wisdom, and allow His Holy Spirit to build those qualities in you that will make you a next generation of leaders that will truly change this country. Stop focusing on what's wrong. Focus on building what is right in you now. Because who you are today defines the future. I always tell young people that, you know, when I'm invited to speak at a conference of adults and there's a conflict invitation with a conference for young people, I choose speaking to young people. I know why I choose to speak to young people. Ask me why. Ask me why. Why? Okay. I choose to speak more to young people. I just spoke to what's called this Nikkei Jinkai Japanese school just last week. I was so inspired just to look at the students, senior high students, talking about true love waits and why not premarital sex. Okay? And so I talked to them and I said, you know, I love you all, but I cannot embrace you all. But I am proud today to stand before you. And I value these moments I'm spending with you. Because I believe if I can inspire you to be the kind of generation that will bring hope to this nation, if I can inspire you to develop those qualities that will make you a generation of change, I believe I just changed the future today. I said, you are not just the hope. I said, you are not the hope of the future. You are the future. Your convictions, your habits is telling me today what the future will be like. And if I can make a change in you right now, if I can inspire you, if I can motivate you to change,
I have changed the future today. I just touched the future today. You are that future. Future generations are waiting for you. They are waiting for you to make the right choices that will affect the conduct and choices of generations to come. The future of this nation, future generations are looking to you right now. If you decide to change and not give in to the evils of your generation, then you made a choice to truly change the future of this country. Thank you for the privilege of touching the future today. Let's pray for our young people. And I say the same thing to the young people of this church. The Philippines has no future without you. I wanted to end the message, but I'm led by the Spirit to tell you a little cute story as my conclusion. There was this village boy, and there was this wise man in the village. This village boy thought he was so smart because he wanted to outsmart the wise man of their village. And so he caught a bird, and he said, I'm going to go to this wise man and hold the bird in my hand at my back. And I'm going to ask the wise man, tell me if you're wise. I have a bird in my hand. Can you tell me if it's alive or dead? And the boy thought, if the wise man says, it's dead, I will let the bird go free and say, you are wrong, it's alive. If the wise man says, the bird in your hand is alive, I will crush it to death in my hand. And then I will show him, you are wrong, it's dead. So whether the wise man will say it's alive or dead, he will be wrong. Smart boy. Amen? But do you think he will outsmart the village wise man? So the next morning he went, he was so excited. He's gonna outsmart the wise man. Wise man, wise man, good morning. Yes, good morning. May I ask you, if you are truly wise, I have a bird in my hand. Can you tell me if it's alive or dead? And the wise man looked at him straight in the eye and said, young man, I do not know if the bird in your hand is alive or dead. But one thing I know, its life is in your hands. Its life is in your hands. If you ask me, does the Philippines have a future? What will I answer? The answer is in your hands. And I speak to the parents. The answer to genuine change in the Philippines has already been given to you by God. They are your children. Your children will determine life or death for the future of this nation. If you spend and invest time to mold your next generation, as God commanded Abraham, for I have chosen him, God said, so that he will instruct his children and his household after him to do, keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice. Then I will bring about my promise to make him a great and powerful nation. He said, Abraham, my promise to you that you'll become a great nation is conditioned on your commitment to mentor your next generations in righteousness and justice. You understand that? Your children are the greatest raw material. They are the most powerful tools to change a nation. Because when they're molded right, with the right convictions and habits, they're going to impact an entire generation and generations to come. How you change a nation It begins where everything begins, in the family. If the family doesn't change, the nation won't. Because the basic character and values that people carry out for the rest of their lives are the ones that have been molded most in the home. The character of a society is simply the reflection of the character of its homes. If you want to ask me, can you predict the future of the Philippines? I usually answer in my talks, show me what's happening in every home in this country, and we'll tell you what the future is like. If that doesn't change, the future is not going to change. Will this nation change? The answer is in your hands today. Model what is right. Mentor, and you will change generations to come. That is the only hope of genuine, lasting change in a nation. Shall we bow for a word of prayer? Father in heaven, I know your heart grieves for the Philippines. In the midst of so much social injustice. But we know the light of day is coming. Because, Lord, we will raise up a next generation who knows you and who fears you. A generation of young men and women who will bear in themselves the qualities that will change a nation. Integrity, spirituality, and compassion. And Father, it is my prayer that you bless every parent who are here this morning. You place in their hands the most powerful tools to transform a nation, and those are their children that you have entrusted to them as a sacred trust, that every potential that they have, that their characters and convictions will be mentored well. So when they take their places in our society, they'll become the lights that will shine in the darkness. And as they multiply in our nation, they will soon change a nation. Lord, help us to focus on what is in front of us. Help us to find what we can affirm and inspire rather than judge and condemn. We can never defeat darkness with darkness, but only with your light. I pray, God, that you'll empower us by our words, our attitudes, as your people, to be the light that the Philippines has been waiting for in the different sectors of society where you place us, in the schools, in the governments, in our social institutions, in the corporate realm, wherever you position each one of us. You want us to shine our light so bright in those areas so that one day we can influence others to follow the same path that we walk, and in time bring about genuine change. Touch our young people. Let them rise up, Lord, to be the kind of men and women who will make a big difference for this country. Help them to understand they are not serving themselves, they are serving you, and they are serving a nation. We know that heaven's eyes look to every young man and every young woman as the seed of hope for the world. For every child born in this world is your seed of hope for mankind. And you've entrusted these seeds into our hands as human parents. And how we nurture these seeds determine whether there will be hope or not for the future of our nation. Change us, O God, as parents, and change our young generation. Make their lives count for eternity. Make their lives count for future generations. Tell them to focus on changing themselves first. Thank you, Father. Forgive us for all our sins and all our slanderous words against our neighbors. Help us, Lord, to encourage rather than to condemn. Help us to inspire rather than to judge. And help us to forgive rather than to hate. Help us to bless rather than curse. Help us to build up rather than tear down. Make us instruments of peace by the way we live. That peace be upon the Philippines, because we are changing. Thank you for your Holy Spirit, who's changing us from glory to glory to become like Christ. We surrender our negative attitudes, Lord, and we ask your forgiveness. Help us to love our neighbor as you have loved us unconditionally. Help us to bless those who curse us, to pray for those who persecute us, to do good to those who hate us, to love our enemies as you have loved us when we were your enemies, and you laid down your life for us. In the end, it is not hatred, but only God's love that can change the world. We thank you for making us agents and channels of your love to the world. In Jesus' name.